Good morning, everybody. Thank you, dear moderators, for the kind introduction. Thank you for the organizers to invite me to give this lecture. Although, like Dr. Verma said, Parvats looks to be so nice. Everybody seems to like it. So why did I accept an invitation with this title? I use it every day. Why would I give a talk on pirates? No. Was it because I really believe that pirates is worthless? Not really. Because I think that I am smarter than Jelle Barends and Jeffrey Weinreb? I don't think so. Or is it because I have no respect for the many years and the high amount of work that were needed to develop pirates? Not really. But because it gave me the opportunity to attend ISRM at Hawaii at reduced fee. That was a very good reason. So we're talking about prostate MRI, multiparametric MRI, and it's not always very easy to make a report of such an exam because it's a combination of morphological information from T2 weighted images, diffuse weighted images, dynamic contrast enhanced imaging, and it used to be to include also in some institutions MR spectroscopy. So reporting prostate MRI and multiparametric prostate MRI is not very easy. So it was a very good step from the ESUR and the ACR and the ADMETEC to make these new guidelines, the PIRET system, like it was described by Professor Verma. So the objectives of PIRETs were fivefold. First one was to provide minimal technical requirements for high quality image acquisition. The second one was to standardize the reporting, to simplify the interpretation, to reduce the inter-observer variability, and to improve the diagnostic accuracy of prostate MRI. So in my talk, I would like to evaluate if PIRETs could achieve these five goals successfully. So first goal was to provide the minimal technical requirements. In PIRETs version 1, there were really clear minimal technical requirements described that we needed to have a high-quality prostate MR exam. In PIRETs version 2, that's no longer the case, and it's only stated that any combination can provide adequate and reliable diagnostic quality when the acquisition parameters are optimized and appropriate technology is used. So they don't make any suggestions anymore about the use of an endorectal coil, yes or no, the use of high field imaging, 1.5T versus 3T, and so on. On one side, that's good. Everybody can do what he likes. But for radiologists who want to start with prostate MRI, this is not a big help. A more important issue is that in PIRETs version 2, dynamic contrast enhanced imaging is recommended in all patients. Like Dr. Verma said, the added value of DCE is DCE plays only a minor role in PIRETs version 2. But moreover, currently, with the improved quality of the diffusion weighted images the last years, the added value of dynamic contrast enhanced imaging over T2 and diffusion weighted images seem to be limited. There are many studies who have been showing this, and also in my own study, where we compared the role of DCE, we found that when you strictly follow the rules of PIRETs version 2 and only look at the DCE images in case of a PIRETs 3 score in the peripheral zone, we saw that only in 20% of patients, DCE is needed. And in 80% of patients, you have scanned the DCE sequence for nothing. I'll show two cases. This is a patient where we have a very suspicious lesion. It's positive on the ADC map. It's clearly visible on T2. You don't need any DCE on a per patient base to show that this is a suspicious lesion. If you add DCE, you only show that it is enhancing. But the added value of DCE is limited. Another case. When you have a perfectly normal T2 weighted imaging, perfectly normal ADC map, DCE does not help much to show you that there is no enhancement. It is not unsuspected, so the added value of DCE is limited, and it can be questioned why it is still recommended to scan in all patients. If we would move over from a multiparametric MRI to a biparametric MRI by omitting DCE, this would simplify the examination because we have fewer sequences. It would be cheaper because we don't need any contrast. It would eliminate the potential risks of the injection of gadolinium. It would also result in a shorter scan time, which would be good to face the increasing demand for prostate MRI. I was recently co-author in a study where we even tried what would happen if we compare a very short, only two sequence, 10-minute protocol to multiparametric MRI. So we compared the performance of multiparametric MRI, including all the sequences, with only diffusion-weighted imaging, and only transverse T2-weighted imaging. So no coronal and sagittal images anymore. And we saw that in the detection of clinically significant prostate cancer in patients with elevated BSA, so to decide do we need a biopsy, yes or no, they performed similar. So this first goal was to provide minimal technical requirements for high quality image acquisition. In the radiological community, the debate is still ongoing about the minimal requirements. Do we need 1.5 or 3T? Do we need endorectal coil, yes or no? But this is not a major issue. I think it's not a major drawback of PI-RADS that it gives not the answer, because I'm really convinced that the prostate cancer detection rates are more importantly influenced by the tumor characteristics, the tumor volume, the Gleason score, the architecture, the location, peripheral zone of transition zone, than the field strength or the coils that are used. In the study of the systematic review that Professor Verma already mentioned, this is also clearly stated when they did subgroup analysis, the accuracy did not change in groups where they scanned on 1.5T as compared to groups where they scanned with 3T. So second goal of PI-RADS was to standardize reporting. Both PI-RADS 1 and PI-RADS version 2 give us a good indication how to score each separate image sequence on a score from 1 to 5, and the DCE was improved because it was a little bit complicated in PI-RADS version 1. In PI-RADS version 2, DCE is negative or positive, so that's very well. So PI-RADS version 2 provides explicit criteria to score each sequence and provides consistent instructions to determine the overall assessment category. In PI-RADS version 1, this was a little bit of a problem because there were no really instructions on how to calculate the overall assessment category. So in PI-RADS, we have a 5-point score, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, where the score 3 means equivocal. It means that it suggests that to the clinician that the clinically significant cancer, the presence of a clinically significant cancer is equivocal. This increases the specificity of findings associated with score 1, 2, 4, or 5. And it enables the radiologist to communicate a doubtful finding to the referring clinician. But it's also a problem because this indeterminate MRI remains a problem because the clinician wants, in the end, to need a binary recommendation for further diagnostic procedures. This 5-point scale has ultimately to be translated into a decision to biopsy or not. And then it's difficult. Is a score 3, is it positive or negative? It's not really indicated in a PI-RADS score what it means. Also, score 3, some descriptors, like here, state that a score 3 is if it does not qualify to score 2, 4, or 5. And this raises the possibility of a heterogeneous spectrum of abnormalities all scored 3. And in less experienced readers, the number of patients assessed with the score 3 is sometimes way too high. This is an example of such a patient with a score 3. On T2-weighted images, we have this rather suspicious, maybe, low signal intensities. You cannot say that this is a normal peripheral zone. On the diffusion-weighted images, it looks quite normal, although on the high BVAR images, it's a little bit hyper-intense. In this patient, the contrast showed a diffuse contrast enhancement should be scored negative. But what do we have to say to the clinician? I think we have to say it's an overall assessment score 3. It can be prostatitis, it can be low-grade prostate cancer, but if it is a low-grade prostate cancer, if this is all low-grade prostate cancer, if there is low-grade prostate cancer all over the place, then for many clinicians, this is also considered a clinically significant tumor. So what do we say to the clinician? Does this deserve a biopsy, or is it safe to watch? So this equivocal overall assessment score is a problem. The threshold score for a positive MRI is not defined. So if we said, we would say every PI-RADS score 3 should also have a biopsy, and it can be useful to target the equivocal area. This is against a further argument against DCE, since the only advantage of DCE was to upgrade a score 3 to a score 4. So a clarification of the cutoff value is needed and should be provided in the future versions of PI-RADS, but maybe this will depend on the clinical scenario. In the systematic review of WHO, they looked at the sensitivity and specificity when a cutoff value of 3 was used as compared to when a cutoff value of 4 was used. As we saw in the systematic review, some radiologists use a score 3 as positive, others use a score 4 as positive. This Score 4 may be preferred for general use, because then we have good sensitivity and a good specificity. Cutoff level of 3 may be preferred in when higher cancer detection is needed, for example, in patients who have persistently high PSA despite already a negative biopsy. Then we need a higher sensitivity and the lower specificity is less important. Or maybe we could create a pirate 2F. Then we don't have to decide to biopsy now or later on. We could do just like in the renal cystic lesions, if we could provide a pirate 2F, we could say it's not necessary to do the biopsy right now, but we could do a follow-up MRI within 6 or 12 months. And then this may decrease the number of pirate 3 who require biopsy. In 6 months, if you see an evaluation, you see that a lesion is growing, then the biopsy can be performed. If the lesion stays the same, it can be followed. So third goal of PIROTS was to simplify the interpretation. The PIROTS descriptors are, however, still a little bit complex and prone to subjective interpretation, because in the descriptors, words are used like market or mild to moderate or focal. Or, for example, the score 1 of the two-weighted images in the transition zone is called the normal findings. But what is normal findings? So another thing is also that the lesion characterization remains difficult, because the different single modalities may yield discordant results, resulting in a wide scope of possible interpretations. Although with PIROTS version 2, this concept of dominant sequences has been introduced, which improves makes the interpretation a little more easier. But this seems to be an oversimplification. It also ignores the multi of multiparametric MRI. If you use really strictly the dominant sequence approach, you use diffuse weighted imaging in the peripheral zone, and you should not add the information that the two weighted images may give you also. So I think when we scan a multiparametric MRI, all the sequences should be taken into account when interrogating a lesion. And we did a study in 245 patients with elevated PSA, and we compared the scoring in the same patients with PIROTS version 1 and PIROTS version 2. In PIROTS version 1, using a subjective determination of the overall assessment score based on all the sequences, and in PIROTS version, when scoring the patients with PIROTS version 2, strictly following the dominant sequence approach. In about 90% of cases, PIROTS version 1 and PIROTS version 2 resulted in the same score. Positive and negative was here determined as a score 3 or higher. But in 12% of patients, we saw a discrepant overall assessment score when the same patient was scored with version 1 as compared to version 2. For example, we had 7 cases where T2 and diffuse weighted images were suspicious, but there was absolutely no enhancement, and the MR spectroscopy was completely normal. In that case, we did score this as a negative MRI, and indeed, clinically significant prostate cancer was only present in one of these 7 patients. The other way, in 23 cases, we had lesions where in the peripheral zone, diffusion weighted images were normal, but morphologically, there was a very suspicious lesion, and still, in half of cases about, there was actually a clinically significant prostate cancer. An example here. We have a lesion that is a little bit rounded. It shows a little bit mass effect. It has a low signal intensity on T2 weighted images, but it did not really show restricted diffusion. So according to the PIROTS version 2, this is negative, because the diffuse weighted images are scored 2. So overall assessment score is 2. When you use PIROTS version 1, or a more subjective scoring, you use all the information and you see this suspicious lesion on T2, and it shows enhancement. Well, in half of cases, in this situation, we found a clinically significant prostate cancer. So instead of the really strictly dominant sequence approach, I think we should go to more to finding optimal weighting factors for each sequence. So diffusion-weighted images may still deserve the strongest weighting in the peripheral zone, but there should be a possibility for T2-weighted images to overrule diffusion-weighted imaging. Likewise, in T2, likewise in the transition zone, T2 may keep the strongest weighting, but diffusion weighted imaging should also be able to overrule T2 in case of a heavily restricted lesion. Fourth goal of PIROTS was to reduce the inter-observer variability. This has been evaluated in several studies, but appears to be rather moderate when they compare experienced and less experienced readers or between radiologists from different centers and practice settings. There are many studies on PIRATES version 1, for example, this study of Tiffen Vacher, who showed a poor to only moderate agreement among readers. The weighted K factor was only 0.4, 0.4, 0.3 between the readers, so that's not very good. Another study of Rosenkrantz, also PIRATES version 1, the agreement between the experienced and the less experienced readers was only poor to moderate. Another study of Rosenkrantz also showing that in the transition zone, the agreement between readers was minimal to poor using PIRATES version 1 in a transition zone. But also in PIRATES version 2, it's a little bit better, but it only had a moderate level of inter-observer agreement for readers of varying experience, like in the study of Müller in radiology. We see a kappa score for PIRATES of 0.542 in the peripheral zone, and the overall suspicion score was only 0.46. So there is still room for improvement. Also in a study of Rosenkrantz in radiology 2016 about PIRATES version 2, the reproducibility was only moderate among six experienced radiologists from different academic centers for scoring PIRATES 4 or higher. Fifth goal of PIRATES was to improve the accuracy of prostate MRI. So in the paper itself, the PIRATES score aims to detect or exclude clinically significant prostate cancers. In the PIRATES paper, the definition to compare the prostate MR accuracy, it is suggested to use this definition: any Gleason score larger than 7, with prominence but not predominant component 4, and or tumor volume larger than 0.5 cc, and or tumor stage larger than T3A. The true diagnostic accuracy remains still difficult to determine because it is influenced by the threshold that is used for a positive MRI, like I said before. And also, it depends on the histopathological reference that is used to determine the clinically significant prostate cancer. The problem is that among clinicians, there is still no consensus about what exactly constitutes clinically significant prostate cancer. And this definition is not necessarily the definition that is used by the urologists. So when we compare the detection of clinically significant prostate cancer with multiparametric MRI before PIRATES existed and now, we see that there is a little improvement. Before PIRATES, we found detection rates in this systematic review that was published in 2015. We found detection rates that ranged from 44% to 87%, and negative predictive values ranging from 63 to 98%. And we saw that the results depended on the definition of clinically significant disease that was used. Here is the systematic review of Wu and co-authors that was published recently, showed an improvement. The pooled sensitivity of PIRATES version 2 was 95%, whereas for PIRATES version 1 it was 88%, so it has improved. For similar specificity, PIRATES version 2 73%, PIRATES version 1 was 75%. So that's not too bad. Still, we see, again, a lot of differences in the sensitivity and the specificity depending on the definition that is used, depending on the scan parameters that are used. So the sensitivity and specificity is quite well, but still there is a problem with lesions that are very small. PIRATES version 2 seems to be limited for the assessment of Gleason score 7 tumors, even if when they are very small. So in the study of Vargas, of 2 years ago, there was only a sensitivity of 26% to detect Gleason 7 tumors that are very small in the peripheral zone, and 20% sensitivity for high-grade tumors that were very small. So this is a problem, because PIRATES version 2 states that it is a major objective to detect clinically significant prostate cancer, but it's in fact this definition of clinically significant prostate cancer includes this very small tumor. So PIRATES does not fulfill there its goals. This is a very low sensitivity. So how about other scoring systems? PIRATES is one system, but the Likert scale has been also used in the past. It's a Likert scale is a 5-point scoring system just like PIRATES, but it's more like a subjective characterization of the level of suspicion. There are no fixed criteria, and it's just based on weighting the modalities depending on the analyzing radiologist's impression. And when the results of the single scores are incoherent, the radiologist uses gut feeling to say which one of the modalities is preferred over the other. Another score that has been reported in the literature is the MLS score. It's a 13-level score, first presented by Philippe Weg in radiology in 2013. It's another scoring system, and it's based on the morphology, M, location, and signal intensity, with the three-point score in peripheral zone, three-point in transition zone. And then it gives also a level of suspicion for the different lesions that are found. These scoring systems were compared in some studies. So Tiffaine Vacher in 2014 compared the accuracy of Pirates version 1 with this MLS and Likert scale in 215 patients followed by radical prostatectomy, two senior readers, one junior reader. And they found that in the detection of prostate cancer with a Gleason score higher than seven, equal to or higher than 7, Likert score significantly was more accurate than Pirates version 1. When we look at the areas under the curve, for the overall populations or for the cancers with the Gleason scores larger than 7, the MLS and Likert score, the Likert score scored obviously in all readers better as compared to Pirates. The subjective scoring system, the Likert score, however, requires experience. So a semi-objective scoring system like Pirates can be easier for less experienced readers. Also, Rosenkranz compared the accuracy of Pirates version 1 with Likert. They found, with three radiologists of equal experience, they found that in the peripheral zone there was no clear difference between Pirates version 1 and Likert. In transition zone, Pirates version 1 scored poorer than Likert. Also, the inter-observer variability was compared in the same studies between Pirates version 1, Likert and MLS. And there was Pirates did also perform a little bit worse or worse than the Likert scale and similar to the MLS score. Also in the study of Rosenkranz, the inter-observer variability between the Pirates scale and the Likert scale was quite similar. Of course, all these studies were performed with Pirates version 1. They should maybe be repeated using Pirates version 2, but so far I have no knowledge of this evaluation. So before I come to the conclusion, two final comments on Pirates. First thing is that the Pirates score is purely MRI derived. So separating the radiological interpretation from the rest of the medical and biochemical history weakens the clinical worth of any test. I think that with prostate MRI, we should not try to detect or exclude all clinically significant prostate cancers. I think that prostate MRI performs best to detect and exclude the high-grade and large tumors. We can say to the clinician, there is a large high-grade tumor, yes or no, and then other clinical biomarkers need to be taken into account to determine whether a lesion is clinically significant or not. So therefore, prostate MRI should be incorporated in nomograms, including other relevant information to have better results. Another remark is that some recommendations of Pirates are based only on expert opinion. They lack concrete supporting data. They require evidence-based support or refinement. Two examples, the size threshold of 15 millimeter to upgrade this category 4 to 5. Where does it come from? There are no studies that show that it's better than, for example, a threshold of 10 millimeters. Also, the upgrading of a score 2, the transition zone score 3 to a 4, in case of diffuse and weighted score 5, it's not known whether it's optimal to apply the threshold at 5. Maybe it could be 4, 2. So there may be some improvements necessary. So to conclude, Pirates absolutely has its merits, and the efforts so far are highly laudable. But Pirates does not yet achieve all its goals. Other scoring systems perform similar, or in some cases even better. And further refinements are required, and Pirates should still be considered as work in progress. Thank you for your attention.